Hi guys, welcome to the Tetrahedron chemistry classes. So in today's class we will see the concept of the hybridization in organic molecule, right? So before starting hybridization, you should know the shapes of the various orbitals. As you know, as I can write, shapes of orbitals, right? And you know, basically we have, when we are talking about these shapes of orbitals, so your orbitals can be of s, p, d or f types. Now we will see how we can define the shapes of them. As you know, your orbitals are what? These orbitals are actually the area, or not area actually, it is the volume around the nucleus where the probability of finding the electron is maximum, right? Since we are dealing with the volume, that means we are including the volume element, that means we need three coordinates, that means x, y and z coordinates. So whatever the orbitals would be there, right, they would be distributed among these four coordinates. Say for example, if you look the shape of your s orbital, so you can write s orbital here. I hope my handwriting is clear to you. So when we are dealing with this s orbital, so you, what you can do, so say this is your x axis or x coordinate, this is y coordinate, and this one is your z coordinate. So you can write in this way, this is x, x negative, right? And say this is y negative, and this one is z, this is z negative. So these are the positive coordinates, these are the negative coordinates. In picture you can see, if I want to show you these orbitals or these axes, so you can see in this particular situation. So this you can consider as your z axis. This you can consider as your, this you can consider as your x axis. This you can consider as y axis. And z axis is actually going above and below the plane. So what you are looking right now, you are looking all, whether you see the relation between x and y, they are forming 90 degree angle. Then x and z, and this is y and x, they are again forming 90 degree angle. So all are perpendicular to each other. So if I am talking about the shape of the s orbital, so you see the s orbital, that means whatever the electrons are present in the s orbital, they would be symmetrically distributed among all the axes. That means the electron cloud would be diffuse. Say it would be here, it would be here. So it will form a ball type of structure, ball shape of structure. That means the spherical shape. So the meaning of the spherical shape is that this sphere is symmetrically distributed among all three axes, right? So how you can draw it? You can very easily draw it in this way. So I'm writing it in this way. So this is your s orbital, fine. So in this s orbital, there would be the probability of finding the electron, right? So this is, say for example, this is a general s orbital shape. If you want to compare the shape and size of the 1s and the 2s orbital, so it is obvious that your 1s orbital would be smaller as it is more close to the nucleus, and 2s would be slightly bigger, and so on. In this way you can form this one. So this is your s orbital. Now you can think about your p orbital. Your p orbital, and you know, when you write any configuration, then you have three kinds of shape, that is px, py and pz, three lobes. So here for s orbital I am writing, they are spherical in shape. This I forgot to mention, but right now I am mentioning it. Now this is p orbital, and for p orbital you should remember one thing, p orbitals are dumbbell shaped. They are dumbbell shaped, right? Now what is the meaning of the px, py and pz? So again what I am doing, say this is my x coordinate, this is my y coordinate, and this is my z coordinate. However, it is not mandatory that you can always take this is x, this is y, this is z. You can take any axis, x axis, and any axis y or z axis. It depends on you from which direction you are viewing the orbital, fine. So say this was your x, this was your y, this was your z, and of course these all are the negative coordinates of there. So this is the general phenomenon, right? If I am talking about the px orbital, say I am drawing my px orbital, how I can draw my px orbital? Say this is my z, this is x. So right now I am only focusing on the z axis. So my px orbital generally would be dumbbell shaped in this way. Here you can form in this way. So this is, say, in this particular area, you will find in this particular volume, you will find the electron density, and again you will find the electron density here. This is actually node. Node, you know, the area where the probability of finding the electron is zero actually, right? And forget about this z and z, right? So this is your px. So it is forming dumbbell shape. That's why px is written there. Fine. In this way you can think, right? If this is your three coordinates, so your one dumbbell would be something like that here. It will form a dumbbell here, and other part of the dumbbell here. So this is one half of the dumbbell. This is second half of the dumbbell. In the center there is node. Node where the probability of finding the electron is zero. In the similar way, if you want to draw the structure for say this is, I am considering y. As I already mentioned, it is not necessary always you will take this is z. You can take anyone x, anyone y, or anyone z. So if I am talking about the py, so py clearly means I am interested in this particular one. That means the lobes would be oriented in the py orbital. So again, in this area you can find the probability of finding the electron would be maximum. Now if you want to look here, so this was your px. Now second number is py. This is your, yes, you see, sorry, this is your, say, py, and this is the second lobe of the dumbbell of the py. So this was your px and px. This is your py and this is your py. Obviously you have now you know this would be your pz, just like this, and below again second lobe of the pz. So in this way you can draw your px, py and pz orbital. So conventionally I am showing it in this way here. So you can consider this particular one as pz, right? So this was your px, this was your py, this was your pz. So this is how we can see the shapes of the s and p orbitals, right? Another orbital, you know, again it is see right now, since I'm discussing the hybridization, or I'm going to discuss the hybridization in the organic molecules. So in organic molecules, you know, the carbon is having the atomic number of 6. There is no need of d orbital, but this d, the shapes of the d orbitals would become very, very important when we see the coordination chemistry, right? Especially in the crystal field theory. So in this particular lecture, I am also explaining the shapes of the d orbitals. So how you can go for your d orbitals. For example, you have this, right? And your s was having only one lobe, two orbitals would be there. And your p having px, py and pz, so that is 3. Here in case of the d, 1, 2, 3 and 5, 1, right? And you know the shape of the d orbitals are, they are double dumbbell shape. They are double dumbbell shaped. Fine. So this you can call as dxy. This is dyz. This is dxz. This you may take dx square dash y square, and this could be considered as dz square. In this way you can write. So now it is obvious that there are these d orbitals having double dumbbell shape. So for time being you can recall these dx, dy and dz, they are oriented in between the axis. They are oriented in between the axis. Fine. And your dx square dash y square and your dz square, they are oriented along the axis. Fine. So say I want to draw the dxy shape. So you can write, say I am drawing for dxy. So xy represents again the coordinate. So what you can do, you can very easily form in this way. Say this is your x, this is your negative coordinate of x, this is x, this is the negative, say this is y, this is the negative coordinate of y. As I said, this dxy oriented in between the axis. So one lobe would be in between x and y. You see, here you can find your electron very easily. In this area you can find the electrons also, right? But the shape is the double dumbbell shape. This is only one dumbbell, so you can draw another dumbbell. Fine. So this is your actually dxy. Hey, so this is in between the axis. Now with the help of the model, you can think, say this is your x axis, this is your y axis. So its lobe would be in between this one. So your lobe would be here and here. This is the one dumbbell, right? And second dumbbell here and here. So this is x, this is y. They are forming the lobes in between the x and y, right? In this way you can see the structure. So more correctly, if you want to show them, so you can see, say here is your lobe actually, right? So this is x, this is y, lobe is in between them. Similarly, lobe is in between them here. Similarly, your lobe is in this position, in between x and y. Here, this is x and y. So they are in between the axis. And same is true for your dyz and dxz. Say you can change the coordinate, right? Coordinate change means you can write it is x, it is z. So you can explain xz. And if you write this is y, this is z, so you can also explain the dyz. So I am not taking too much of time to explain this one, because these are the pretty basic one, right? So these are the shapes of these three. But now you can see this particular one. Say this is your dxy. Say they are oriented along the axis. So here I am drawing my dx square dash y square, right? So you can draw this again. This, say this is x axis, this is y axis, right? So I am not mentioning again and again positive and negative negative coordinates. So you can think in this, you can think by your own, right? So this is the x square, y square, they are oriented along the axis. That means they are just on the axis like your p orbital, right? That means the orientation is just like the p orbital. However, they are double dumbbell shape. So the one lobe is on the x axis and the other lobe would be on the y axis. So this is actually your dx square dash y square. In this way you can understand this thing. Now coming to this one, this the shape of this dz square is pretty much important. This is very, very important to know, right? So why it is very important to know? So I am drawing it here. Say this is my dz square, right? So what happens, you see this particular one. So here you can write, say x coordinate, and for timing I am taking this as z axis, right? And of course this would be your y coordinate. So if you closely look the shape of this particular orbital, then you will find a very interesting feature associated with this particular one. Actually it is on the z axis here, but x and y coordinates are also there. So you see this, all this is also having this x contribution as well as your y contribution. So these two contributions are also there. Third component, how you can write, you see this is dz square. Actually this is made up of by the two combination, that is dy square dash dz square, right? Y and z. Similarly, another contribution in this particular one is your dx square dash z square, right? This is formed actually, this dz square formed in this way. So it is not having the x z component only. This z component is also having dy and dx component, because x and y axis are also there. So what you can do, you can roughly draw it in this way, because in textbook it is shown in this way, this particular circle, right? So you, as you can see, this dz square is having z component from this particular contribution and as well as z component from this particular contribution. So what happens due to this, z component becomes more, and you see the lobe of this orbital, the size of the lobe of the orbital increases in the z direction, right? So it is very important, size of the lobe of orbital increases in z direction, right, while the size decreases in the x and y direction. So the x and y direction, so this is very important to note that. So this is the behavior of these orbitals. Now we will see how we can combine them actually. So for the combination of them, so see, for since we are discussing organic molecules, so this is enough for your d orbital shape. Now I am going to explain how these orbitals are combined to form the orbital. So formation of, here I am writing formation of sigma and pi bonds, formation of sigma and pi bonds, right? In this way I can add this. So as you know, sigma bonds, here I am writing sigma bonds, they are formed by axial overlap or head-on overlap, and these sigma bonds are strong. Why they are strong? Because overlapping is maximum, fine, and your pi bonds, they are formed by the lateral overlap or also known as sideways overlap. That means it is weak. Why weak? Because overlapping is less in this case. So you can notice one thing. Say I am giving it as the point number one. Whenever s orbital combines with s orbital, it will always result in the sigma bond. Why? Because s orbitals are symmetrically distributed among all the axes. So in whatever fashion the two atomic orbitals, the wave functions of the two orbitals are coming actually, they will extend, they will overlap to that extent which is maximum actually. So it will always result in the sigma bond, right? So now second situation, you can think in this way. Say S is combining with the P, again it will form only the sigma bond. Why? Because S is symmetrically distributed. So whatever your P orbital is, whether it is Px, Py or Pz, so you can think in this way, right? Say this is your orbital, say this is your Px and here your S orbital. So when they overlap, so this S orbital is symmetrically distributed among all the axes. So S orbital would be maximum in the x axis. So this x would combine and the maximum overlap would be there. Now somehow if your Px is not coming, say your Py is coming this way. Here you see your Py is coming here. Fine. Say your Py is coming. So again, see S is spherical. My hand is showing the spherical nature here. So spherical S again would have the maximum electron density in the y direction also. So it will form the sigma bond. Same is true for the z orbits. See, z axis. So s, when combined with p, it will always be in the sigma bond. So you can note one thing, whenever your s orbital is combining with any orbital, it is always resulting in the sigma bond formation. Fine. So now number 3 point, what about the p orbitals actually? So p, when combined with p orbitals, when combined with b, it may result on sigma bond, it may result on the pi bond, right? Now you can see this p plus p forming sigma bond. So how they can form the sigma bond? Now you can think in this way. Say this is the, say you can leave it, say I am putting my fingers in this fashion here. So what you can see right now, this is my say x coordinate, and this thumb is my y coordinate, and this is the z coordinate. Now you can think another set of orbitals, right, in this way. So this is px, this is px, this is py, this is py, and this these thumbs are pz. So once this px, px are coming through the axis, so they will overlap to the maximum extent and they will result in the sigma bond. Now what options are available for this y and for this z? They cannot combine axially. Why? Because the bond is formed now and they cannot come along the axis. So what they can do, they can literally overlap, and whenever this lateral overlap occurs, then the bond would be weaker and it will result in the pi bond, right? This is the case of the px orbital. Now you can think in this way, your px is not involving, actually your py is involving. So what happens, your py would come in this fashion. So your py would form sigma, rest 2 would form your pi bond. So it is very important to note that px, py or pz, any orbital can form your sigma bond, right? So I can write it here. So whether it is px, py, pz, anyone can form sigma bond depending upon the internuclear axis selection. So however, this statement is not looking very good, but you can think in this way. Say two px are coming, so they will form the sigma bond. If you consider your px as the internuclear axis, so px would form sigma bond. Now in any case, you are not considering your px as the internuclear axis. You can think about that your py is the internuclear axis. That means first py would form bond, it would be sigma, rest 2 would be pi. Same is true for the pz. If pz are coming through the axis, they will form the sigma, rest will form the pi bond. So this is how you can see. So very quickly, I can show you the pictorial diagram, how they can overlap. So first I am showing this s plus s. Say here I can write, say my one coordinate is here, and here you can see my second coordinate. So what happens here, you see, say this is my the s orbital of one, and this is the s of the other. So in this way they can combine. So this is actually the overlapping area. So this will result in the sigma bond. This is S and S combination, right? And now you can think in this way. So I am drawing it the picture a little bigger now, as I am thinking that these pictures are not quite visible to you. That's why I am drawing now little bigger in size. Fine. So again, you can think, say this is your S orbital, and here you can see your p orbital is coming. So this is the area of overlapping. S and p always form sigma. Fine. Now you can think about p and p. For example, these are the two p's. Say you can see one p is coming in this way. That is the px. this is the x-axis icon, suppose it, and this is again the p-axis. So they are coming through the axis. You see, they are coming through the axis. Whenever they are coming through the axis, this area of overlap is maximum and it will result in the sigma bond. Now you can think another situation. How another situation you can think? Say I have now left, this was the px px, now I have my py, so I am drawing it with a green. This is py, so this is also py. Fine, these two are the pys. So when these two are the pys, so now once this px px bond has already formed, this bond is already formed actually through the axis, now there is no choice left for the py orbital except they can overlap laterally. So how they would overlap? So this would overlap with this one, this would overlap with this particular one. Fine, so this is how you can see, clear? So this is the p, this is the pi, and this is pi, this middle one is the sigma one. So this is the concept of the formation of the sigma and the pi bond, right? So when they are coming axially, they are forming sigma bond, right? So it is important to write axial here, right? When it is forming pi bond, so they are coming laterally. So in this way you can understand these concept of the formation of the bonds, right? So now in the next class I'll continue with the concept of the hybridization, right?